We've traveled a long way for this special edition of Living Truth to the beautiful countries of Greece and Turkey. We'll be walking in the footsteps of two apostles, Paul and John, as we relive biblical history. We'll visit historic sites and study God's Word, considering how it impacted the people of the time and continues to transform us 2,000 years later. Stay with Living Truth for a message from Hillary Price.
Take my yoke. I and the Father are one. You and I will be one.
This message was recorded in Athens, Greece, during a retreat with Living Truth viewers on the shore of the Aegean Sea.
Revelation chapter 1, if you'd like to turn there. Verse 9, I was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. And remember, we looked at, I was on the island. And verse 10, on the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit. So today we're going to look at what that means in the life of John. I was in the Spirit, and of course the Spirit was in me. He was intimately one with the Lord Jesus Christ, and in that intimate relationship, he saw things that no one had ever seen, and he heard things that nobody had ever heard before, and he recorded them as fast as he could before the images faded and the visions disappeared. He was in the Spirit, he was one with Jesus. And being one with Jesus, he'd actually stepped into the answer to the prayer that Jesus prayed in John 17. I hope you've got your Bibles. In John 17, verse 14, Jesus showed what was going to happen, and he said, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them. And the world hated John for the word and imprisoned him for it. For they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. Jesus was always showing him this other world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. And John's life is the answer to that prayer. Jesus protected him from the evil one. He sanctified him. He sent them into the world. And he ended up on the island of Patmos. If you read on in that prayer, Jesus goes on to say, I pray also for those who will believe me through their message. And I've never forgotten that, because Jesus intercedes for us. And sometimes you may feel there's nowhere, nobody knows, nobody cares. And just hear Jesus say, I'm praying for you. And he prayed for us in John 17, those who will believe me through their message. We are those who have believed through the message. We are all standing here on somebody else's shoulders. We're standing on the shoulders of Paul, who had the courage to make this journey not on cruise ships but on battered old boats which fell apart, and he just kept going. And John, who would not stop speaking the word of God, we're standing on their shoulders. Think in your heart whose shoulders you are standing on, and thank God for them. And who is standing on your shoulders? Anybody? Or have you kept all this to yourself? John would not keep it to himself. And as time went on, he lost his friends, and it was just him and Jesus. Verse 9, he is in solitude and he is in suffering. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that we don't have naturally, but that is ours in Jesus. You have not got what it takes to live and survive and thrive in this life. But Jesus does. Apart from him, I can do nothing. His strength is made perfect in weakness. Patience, endurance that are ours in Jesus. And however many people you surround yourself with who prop you up, in the end, it's you and God. And I think part of John's loss here, of his many losses, was grief. Very painful grief. And God got him on his own to speak deeply into his life and to show him it wasn't over and there was a future, and there was a future that was bigger and more amazing than he had ever, ever imagined. Everybody who God invites into his story has to have a deeply personal, painful encounter with God. There's no way around that. There's only a way through it. And in the midst of it, you meet the man of sorrows himself. If you look through scripture, the people who God used and who were part of his story had this deep encounter. He always got them alone. Abraham, Hagar, Jacob, Moses, Joshua, Mary, Jesus' mother, Mary Magdalene. It's a great study to open your Bible and say, God, show me where you got people on their own and what did you do in that encounter with them? You cannot be a disciple from a distance. I'm going to say that to you again. You cannot be a disciple from a distance. And there comes a point, and we talked about this, where you realize everything in your life is leading to this moment where you personally encounter God. And it can be very, very difficult. I love Jacob's encounter with God. Jacob was a cheat and a thief, and most of us would have completely given up on him. But God had purposes for Jacob. And one night when Jacob was running, he was always running. He wasn't running to things, he was always running away from things. And God just blocked his path. And he wrestled all night with a man. It was God. And he got to a place of saying, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And God knocked his hip out of joint and he walked with a limp for the rest of his life, but he knew God. Do you walk with a limp because you know God, because you've wrestled with him? When I get into the dark with God, I hang on for the blessing. I say, God, I will not let you go until you bless me. I hate this dark place. I want to be out of this dark place, but you're in it and I'm going to wrestle with you. I wrestle in the night so often. The older I get, the more awake I am at night. And I've stopped thinking, I just need to get to sleep. I've started to think, okay, here we go, God. Let's begin the wrestling match because there's something going on here and I will not let you go until you bless me. And then I continue to limp my way through life. And John, in his loneliness and painful loss, encountered God in an incredibly profound way. Look at his life. He'd lost everything. He'd lost his church family in Ephesus and the other churches which we think he probably oversaw. He lost Jesus' mother, Mary. He'd lost his selfless father, Zebedee. He'd lost his brother, James. He'd lost his leadership role. He'd lost his home. He'd lost his hometown. But there's one thing he hadn't lost. He hadn't lost his relationship with Jesus. And his intimacy with Jesus deepened in the loneliness, and it deepened in the fires of testing. When he left the shores of Galilee, remember, he was pretty gung-ho, a little bit selfish, looking for his self-aggrandizement. But as he got deeper and deeper into drinking the cup with Jesus, even death, his relationship is still intact. And I hope, if you haven't read John's letters, in the light of what we've discovered about him, that you will read them. And let the Lord just love you through them, because they're three letters all about love. And in 1 John 1:3, he says, our fellowship is with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. Not was, not it's all over because Jesus died, but is because Jesus rose again and by his Spirit he lives in me. And his first three letters just, they encourage, in the first of his letters, he encourages, dear children, just stay in that dependent place with the Father. I wonder if you know this present, ongoing fellowship with the Son. You see, when we come to Christ, come to me, all you who are weary, and I'll give you rest. We come to him, but we don't just come to Jesus once. Once we've received the Lord Jesus and he lives in us, there's a continual coming to him. Come to me is the first commandment of the Christian life. The next one, all you need to know is abide in me. That basically sums up the Christian life. Come to me, abide in me. So we keep coming. Take my yoke. I and the Father are one, you and I will be one. And Jesus has prayed that you and he may be one. And the outworking of that is a love relationship, usually through incredibly difficult times, in a crazy world, where we take time, where we live in that present awareness that I am loved, and therefore I can love. I don't know if you get very frustrated in your life and you think, I have a hard time loving people. You're looking at the wrong place. Don't look at the people that you're having a hard time loving. Look inside yourself and ask yourself, am I allowing myself to be loved? Do I really know what it is to be loved by God? Do you know what it is to be his beloved? There's a beautiful verse in Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. The Lord your God is living among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all your fears. He will rejoice over you with joyful songs. Does his love calm all your fears? I think fear is probably one of the biggest problems in the lives of the people I talk with. And I talk with a lot of people and I listen to them. And most of what they say is fear-based. Fear about themselves, fear about their families, fear about the future. Fear, 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 fear. With his love, he will calm all your fears. That says he recognizes them. He's not saying you shouldn't have any. He's saying, I know your fears. But perfect love, what does what? Casts out fear. He sees the fear. Don't pretend you haven't got them. Just allow him, with his love, to calm your fears. And John, because he was the beloved, he speaks out of an incredibly calm place, in a horrific geographical place, a concentration camp on a rocky island, basically. That's where he is. And yet he knows who he is in that place. Some of us are very much drawn to the limelight. But it's in the shadows when you're alone that you really, really encounter Jesus and you know your identity in him. John knew all about taking a back seat and quietly allowing himself to be loved. John 14:6, we know and rely on the love God has for us. All I'm talking to you about today is love. What does the love of God mean in our lives? Do we rely on the love of God? That's all part of letting the love of God calm us in our fears. John wrote his gospel and crazy things were happening around him. Miracles and imprisonment and flogging and persecution and churches being born. And he stood in his belovedness and he did not need the applause of the crowd. He absolutely knew who he was. He didn't need an audience. And if you need an audience, you do not know who you are in Jesus Christ.
This is a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Living Truth viewers joined Hillary and Charles Price on an unforgettable trip, following in the footsteps of Paul. Along with exploring biblically historic sites such as Ephesus in Turkey, our time together included destinations such as Pergamum, Sardis, Pamukkale, and Cappadocia. Our Living Truth travelers also enjoyed visiting the Greek islands of Santorini, Patmos, and Rhodes. Ancient Smyrna, now part of modern Izmir, was another strategic port city northwest of Ephesus. Alexander the Great conceived the idea of its restoration and fortification, and it became a principal Roman city in Asia. It was one of seven cities that formed a natural postal route from Ephesus along the coast. Although there is no official record of how Christianity came to Smyrna, it's likely that it was reached as a result of Paul's ministry in Ephesus. We hear it named as one of the seven churches in the book of Revelation, and later, its bishop Polycarp was famously martyred here.
This series was recorded on location in Turkey and Greece and is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen. To order this series, go to livingtruth.ca for details. Receive the gospel and experience Turkey and Greece as you follow in the footsteps of Paul.
This is a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Living Truth viewers traveled to Greece and Turkey to explore and experience the Living Bible. Let's return to our message from Hillary Price.
There's a very important message for us in the fact that John knew it was the Lord's Day. See, when it gets difficult and you're in the dark and you can't see him anymore, it's easy to give up on God when you think you're never going to hear from him again. And I would encourage you to keep doing the things you know to do. Keep going to church, even if it frustrates you. Keep gathering together with other Christians. Keep reading your Bible. Keep praying, and one day you will hear him speak again. Just keep turning up in the places you know God is present. In your own personal life, keep opening the scriptures. I went through a very hard time for a period when our children were little, and I began to think I would not hear God speak again. Just keep turning up, and God will, I promise you, he will speak to you again. His word is living and active, and it will never die. There just will be times in your life you can't hear him. And Jesus, who brings you to the dark place, who brings you to the island, he will meet you there. Keep trusting Jesus. And John continues to worship. And worship is a sign that you are still trusting. He's still in the Spirit. I was in the Spirit because the Spirit is in him. Remain in my love. And only when you're still trusting, and only when you're still listening, and only when you're still open to God, even though you can't hear him, you will do. You will still hear the voice of God. Revelation 1 verse 10, on the Lord's day I was in the Spirit and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. John, we're still in business. I'm still speaking to you. And maybe because he's a little old, he's a little deaf, and he has to speak in a loud voice. I don't know why he speaks in a loud voice. But you'll never get so old you can't hear the voice of God. He will always make it possible for you to hear him. John knows that Jesus is still working out his story, and Jesus reassures John, don't be afraid, it's me, I am alive forever. And once he turns and looks, he's led deeper and deeper into these marvelous truths about Jesus. And he's taken far beyond the boundaries of this little island that he's on, this island of Patmos, 10 miles long, 6 miles wide, coastline of 37 miles. This is not all there is, this little island that you are on. Now it has 3,000 inhabitants and 5 schools and 400 churches on that island. This little contained place, there's always more. And in the Spirit, John is invited in Revelation 4 verse 1, come up here, come up here. And the invitation's still open. We are seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Just come up here and let's have a little look. Revelation 4, 1 to 3, come up here and I will show you. So in the Spirit, I looked at where he took him in the Spirit. He finds himself in the throne room. In Revelation 17, verse 3, he finds himself in the Spirit in the desert. In Revelation 21, verse 10, in response to come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb, he finds himself high up on a mountain, seeing the holy city of Jerusalem coming down from heaven. John records these amazing sights, and he just keeps saying, then I saw, and then I saw, and then I saw. Maybe you've never seen because you've never come. You've never taken the first step when you've been invited into the mystery of who Jesus is. And I wonder what is stopping you coming. The first question God ever asked a human being was, where are you? And the thing that stopped them coming was shame. Remember Adam and Eve hid in the bush. He asked them because he wanted them to say, this is where I am, hiding in the bush. And it might be that you need to humbly say to God, this is where I am, hiding in the bush. And I hear that woman up there continually saying, come to me, come if you're weary, come out of the tree, come out of the boat, come, come, come. And I am not coming. And the reason I'm not coming is maybe because I'm too prideful, but maybe because I'm so covered in shame, I just can't come out of the bush. Behold, I am coming soon. Revelation 22:12. Revelation 22:17. Jesus is still saying the same thing. He will not stop offering this invitation. The Spirit and the bride say, come. This is his invitation from the beginning of time to the end of time. You can still come to me. Why is John so willing to come to Jesus? It's very simple. Because he trusts the love of Jesus. We're not willing to come to people who we don't trust. And Jesus says, come. And the only reason we will ever come to Jesus is when we trust his love, when we know his love, when we've learned to lean into his love. I think one of my favorite verses in the whole of scripture, because it's my testimony, is the Song of Solomon, chapter 8, verse 5. And it says this, who is this coming up from the wilderness, leaning on her lover? See, it's in the wilderness we learn to come. It's in the wilderness, Song of Solomon 8, verse 5, we learn to lean on our beloved, on our lover. That's where I've learned to lean on Jesus, is on the island of Patmos, in the dark place and in the desert. I'm going to talk a little bit about solitude, because when God gets you on your own, on an island, on the shore, you will discover if there's actually anything between you and God. To be brutally honest. So you can keep going with the group and we can all be swept up in, this is great, we all know God. And maybe some of us don't. And maybe this one-on-one is an excruciating thing for some people. And maybe it's a hard thing to have been put into that place to come to the realization, actually, Jesus, I've never listened to you before, I've never talked with you. But there's always the first step. The first step where you begin to trust his relationship with you. Revelation 2:1-7, he starts to write to Ephesus, this church that's beginning to crumble. He writes, Revelation 2, to the angel of the church in Ephesus. These are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know you cannot tolerate wicked people. You've tested those who claim to be apostles but are not and have found them false. You've persevered and endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. Yet, I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first, your first love. Consider how far you've fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. The disciple of love isn't so loving that he refuses to speak truth. Love has to be tough. And it's his love that determines what we say to those he loves and we love. Sometimes you hold back and don't say things to people because you fear you might hurt them. That's not loving. Because in the end, you are keeping the truth back from them. tough love is extremely difficult. As a pastor, as a teacher, we have to speak the truth, even though it's sometimes incredibly uncomfortable. If we love people, then we must speak the truth. In a marriage, in a friendship, sometimes God gives you words and insights. You don't want to pass them on, but you know they're true. I've had to do this sometimes in our marriage. One time, it absolutely broke me to confront my husband. Absolutely broke me, and everything in me did not want to do it. But God showed me something, and I have to obey God, not men. And so I did it. Love is not soft and soppy. It wants the best for the person you love. So you die to yourself and you say, I will say the thing, even though you might not want to hear it, because I know this is true. Tough love is very courageous love, and it's ruthless. It will not let anything get in its way. And that's Jesus' love for you. Whether you want it, whether you like it, whether you know that you need it or not, he will not stop loving you. So you can resist all you want, but in the end, he will get you on your own. And everybody else's love will have fallen away. And John has never lost his first love. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you, could be John's theme song. He has never stopped loving Jesus. And he's never stopped believing that Jesus loves him, which is more important. I've thought a lot about the first love that Ephesus, the church at Ephesus, has lost. And I've come to the conclusion that it's not their love for God that they are expressing through working for him. It's their awareness of his love for them. We love him because he first loved us. If you've lost your first love, that's what you've lost. You've lost your reception, awareness, understanding of his first love for you. That's the first love that they've lost. Our love is simply a response to that.
You are watching a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey.
The Greek island of Patmos, just off the coast of Turkey, may be tiny, but its biblical significance is huge. The book of Revelation explicitly states that it was written while the Apostle John was in exile on the island. This is the only book in the New Testament where the place of writing is given. Much of our New Testament comes from this part of the world. Letters to Corinth, Thessalonica, Philippi, and Ephesus are all found in the Bible we hold today. Paul's first three missionary journeys saw significant stops at major towns and cities in these lands, and he returned often, more than once, to strengthen the new believers. He lived to see Christ being formed in them and had the utmost dedication to their growth and the church's survival. His conversion encounter with the Christ he was persecuting so dramatically changed him, his life became one of complete surrender to go wherever Christ led him. It's humbling and inspiring to see the impact his dedication had on our history.
Let's return to our message from Hillary Price.
We are not workers for God, we are workers together with God. There are so many Christians who are working their butts off for God. They know nothing of his love. They equate work with love. God, I'll work so hard for you, you'll be so impressed, and I'll show you how much I love you. And God says, let me love you, just stop. Stop what you're doing. You're doing it all in your own strength. It's all performance-oriented. Who are you trying to impress? Because, hello, I'm not impressed. And you know, sometimes a busy outside life is an absolute phony, and it's a complete cover-up people see busy people and they say they're such hard workers. Let me tell you something. A lot of very hardworking, driven people on the outside are extremely lazy on the inside. Because on the inside is where you do the hard work with Jesus Christ, where he topples the idols of your soul. And you don't want that, so you just get busier and busier and busier for him, and he is not in the slightest bit interested. He says, let's do the hard soul work. Come alone with me, and let's talk together. A refining fire is the love of God. It burns deep within our souls. If I stop running around, I'm going to have to feel. If I stop running around, I'm going to have to think. I don't want to feel. I don't want to think. So I'm just going to spin faster and faster and faster. And everybody is going to be so impressed with me, because nowadays we actually think busyness means value. Somebody says, can I meet with you? And you say, yeah, you can meet with me next month on Tuesday afternoon. I have two hours. I can slot you in. Aren't I great because I'm such a busy person? No. Remain in me, Jesus says. Remain in my love. And that takes time and it takes relationship. God loves me. Stand up tall. I am a daughter of the King. God loves me. I don't care what you think about me, frankly. My identity is not in what you think about me. That frees you and it totally frees me. Because I'm not having conversations with you, trying to manipulate you and wonder if you like me. I am God's beloved. And that is my identity. And that was John's identity. That's my first love. I've received the first love. He loved me. And so I can love him back. And it's in solitude that we step into and receive and are transformed and cleansed by the love of Christ. In solitude, all unresolved pain rises to the surface. And that might have happened to you. When the noise that you previously used to drown out the pain stops, the pain starts to shout very loud. Psalm 39, verses 2 to 5. I was silent and still. Look what happened. My anguish increased. You don't go alone with God and suddenly feel all calm. You step into a battleground. Either the battleground of saying, God, I haven't spoken to you. I haven't had an hour with you ever in my life. I used to, maybe, when I first became a Christian. I never do this anymore. I hate it when people come to me and say, I never spend time with God like that. Why? Why? Do you love him? Do you know he loves you? Or is it that when the silence stops, it's so difficult? Psalm 39, my heart grew hot within me. So instead of your soul settling down, it starts to get very, very noisy and perturbed. And another thing that happens in solitude, you discover what you depend on. Because it's only when you're deprived of something that you realize how much you need it. And when you take the thing away that people depend on, it's like a drug for people. They start manifesting withdrawal symptoms. You take the cell phone off some people, they get angry, they get irritated, they get aggressive. That's withdrawal symptoms. You take somebody off cocaine, that's how they manifest withdrawal. So what are you dependent on? You will never know that until you take it away and you step away. The cell phone, food, television, noise, friends, applause, even the adrenaline rush of arguing with your partner and winning. That can be something that people feed on. They love it in their marriage. Let me tell you what Nouwen says. I've probably learned more from Nouwen about solitude than from anybody, and this is what he says. As soon as we are alone, inner chaos opens up in us. The chaos can be so disturbing and so confusing that we can hardly wait to get busy again. Entering a private room and shutting the door, therefore, does not mean that we immediately shut out all our inner doubts, anxieties, fears, bad memories, unresolved conflicts, angry feelings, and impulsive desires. On the contrary, when we have removed our outer distraction, we often find that our inner distraction manifests themselves to us in full force. We often use the outer distractions to shield ourselves from the interior noises. This makes the discipline of solitude all the more important. You see, when you get alone with God, all hell breaks loose. Let me tell you, it literally does. But nothing can separate us from the love of God. But it will try in your life and in the secret place. And solitude is not opting out of the world and becoming disconnected from it. It's becoming disconnected from your need for the world. When you detach yourself from your need for other people to meet your need, to give you your identity, to understand you, you actually free them to love you. And you free yourself to point them to Jesus to meet their need. You see, if in your marriage you're spending your whole time trying to meet each other's needs, you're going to be in big trouble. In a marriage, nobody can satisfy their partner fully. Only Jesus Christ. God gives us the desires of our heart, and our desire is for Him. And only He can satisfy the desires He's created. And yet so many marriages are floundering because we have expectations of the other person that they can never fulfill. So in a marriage, of course we meet each other's needs up to a point, but together we encourage each other to find our all in all in Christ. And in solitude, I battle with my own struggles, but you know, what is personal is universal. You don't have any struggles that I don't have. Sometimes people say to me, how do you know what to say to your audience? Do you know your audience? And I say, no, I know me. And I know all the things I struggle with, and I'm a normal person. So if I do the work and attend to my own stuff, I'm actually attending to your stuff as well. I have all the same fears, doubts, disappointments, longings that you have. So that's how I know how to speak. Not by looking at you all and thinking, what does she need? What does he want? I just attend to Christ in me and what he reveals to me about me and to me about him. And it makes me love you more because I know his love for me in all my weaknesses and all my longings, so I know his love for you. So it's completely mutual. And John is the disciple who Jesus loved, and therefore he is the most loving disciple. It's so simple. You've lost your first love. Get back to not loving God more, but letting God love you. And out of that will flow your love for other people. This is a journey. It's a journey that will have revealed to you whether or not your heart belongs to God. Patmos is not a punishment. Patmos, the time, the moment, the place where God has got you on your own, it is a privilege. It's the greatest privilege. Patmos is where we are invited to rediscover our first love, God's love for me, to lean on my lover, Jesus. We love because he first loved. Patmos is where in the quiet and solitude, you maybe for the first time will hear his voice to you because he's called you by name. And Patmos is where God will finally have got you alone. And you will realize that you are his destination and he is your destination. And God has pulled you aside on this journey. He's pulling you aside in this reflection time to say one thing to you. I love you. I love you. I love you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you that your love is relentless. ruthless, undying, unfailing, uncompromising. Thank you that we can sing, O love that will not let me go, I rest my weary soul in thee, I give thee back the life I own. Forgive us, Lord, for clutching at our lives, for looking to the world to tell us who we are, for generating energy out of nothing and watching it continually seep away. Oh God, renew our understanding. Return us to our first love, which is your love for us. You so loved the world, you sent Jesus. And Jesus, you so loved the Father that you came. Thank you. Thank you that whatever we did and whatever we've done, you continue to love us. Thank you, Lord, that you wait for us on the other side of failure. Thank you that you call us out of the place where we hide. Thank you that you are the hound of heaven and you will relentlessly pursue us. I pray for each person who is on this journey but who has never made the first step in response to your invitation, come to me. I pray even this morning, God, you would give them the courage to fall into your arms, to relax in your embrace, to trust your love when they can't trust anybody else's, maybe because they were hurt as a child, maybe they were hurt in a marriage, but you love us. God, break through with your love into our lives today. And help us leave this journey knowing one thing, I am my beloved's and he is mine. In Jesus' name, and for his sake, amen.
You are watching a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Our Living Truth group enjoyed traveling and worshiping together and meditating on God's Word as a community or in quiet reflection.
I'm a minister with the Presbyterian Church in Canada, Western Toronto. And what prompted me to come on this trip was to explore some of the archaeological background of the New Testament and to get a better sense of the setting within which the Word was presented to human beings. While you're with people, you're speaking with them, eating with them, praying with them, worshiping with them, you're moving around with them through various sites, and you get to know them very well, and you get to just express Christian life together. I would recommend this trip for everyone in the church. I think people, young people, older people, ministers, worship leaders, anyone who's living and breathing within the communion should come to this part of the world and explore the heritage that is ours through Jesus Christ. Well, it brings everything to life being here. It's like you look at a black and white photograph and then you see it in color. It sort of just refreshes that perspective. My expectations for this trip have been met and exceeded in many ways. I expected to enjoy the fellowship with other Christian believers, and that certainly has been met. And I have also been able to appreciate all the venues we have been to, the museums and the different archaeological sites. So in many ways, it's just everything I could have asked for. I have no regrets, and anyone who does come will have no regrets. If I were to sum this trip up so far with one word, it would be involving. Totally involving.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a trip of a lifetime that celebrates all things Israel. From November 17th through to the 27th, 2016, join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we explore Israel.
Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, you'll visit Via Dolorosa, the Mount of Olives, Beit She'an, Caesarea, Mount Carmel, and many more amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hilary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
I'd like to personally invite you to join Hilary and myself for a wonderful and rich experience in the land of Israel in November 2016. We're calling this trip Awaken 2016 Israel. Whether this is your first trip to Israel or you're returning with us to this beautiful, significant country, imagine a journey where you'll immerse your senses and deepen your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Most of the key events in Scripture took place in the land of Israel. And we'll visit places whose names have probably been familiar to you for many years. We'll be fascinated by the historical sites and events and be able to soak up spiritual significance that is associated with them. This is a vacation like no other. You'll enjoy the sights, sounds, and great food of the Holy Land, as well as wonderful warm fellowship with like-minded travelers. And we've set aside ample quality time to refresh and rejuvenate the spirit. Towards the end of our journey, we'll stop and take time in the Word of God together. Hilary and I will teach at a 2-day haven of reflection in a private venue right on the shore of Lake Galilee. Our hope is that we may encounter the living Christ and come away in a deeper relationship with Him. Awaken 2016 Israel holds the potential to invigorate us physically, to enrich us socially, and to refresh us spiritually. Like many who have journeyed with us before, you may come home knowing you'll never be quite the same again. Don't miss this opportunity. Please join Hilary, me, and the Living Truth family on this exciting journey. We hope to see you in Israel in November 2016.
Save these dates, November 17th to the 27th, 2016. To reserve your spot now, visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Israel, Awaken 2016. It's your time.
During our trip, we enjoyed a rejuvenating respite with Hilary Price.
You're entering a different phase of your life, and as you look forward, what do you see?
What do I see? I honestly don't know at the moment. I just turn up in my boat and await instructions. I don't know far ahead right now. I have my mum and dad in England who are getting older. My dad's 92, yeah. My mum's 84. I feel they've given a lot up for us being in Canada. I'd love to have a bit more time with them. I don't know what that looks like really. I was deeply impacted reading. Again, this is another example of God speaking in the secret place. I was reading the scriptures one day about when Jesus was carrying his cross and he was struggling and falling, and Simon was there and he said, Simon, carry the cross for a while, basically. Right. And so it was Jesus's cross, but Simon had to carry it. And in that moment, I knew our journey has been our cross, but my parents have had to carry it. And I know God knows that. I know He understands that they've been a part of this journey. And I sort of think my mum is beginning to glimpse that. That she once said to me, I think I had you for a purpose that was nothing to do with me. Which is a massive thing to have said.
Isn't it?
Yeah. So they've been incredibly kind and gracious, but in my gut, I feel that I need to go and have some time there. So I don't know what that looks like.
I just wonder if you could just share a little bit from your own heart and your own life about how, when you receive a phone call from Canada that says your husband has had a heart attack and you might not see him again unless you come quickly. Mm-hmm. And the only thing you had to cling on to was the the faithfulness of God, the love of God in your life. Tell us, how did you know that was there? And what was that, when you clung onto it, what does that mean? Can you just talk about that?
I knew it was there because God actually, in my quiet moments with him, months before, had whispered to me Charles was going to have a heart attack.
Wow.
So I usually become very distressed in my spirit, and I can't always identify what it is. And I become very distressed in my spirit, and I sense God saying to me, he's going to have a heart attack. And I went with a friend of mine, I didn't say a word to Charles, I went with a friend of mine, a lovely German girl, and I said to her, I'm so burdened in my soul. And she said, why? And I said, because I think Charles is going to have a heart attack. So we prayed, and Charles went to Canada, and I wrote him a letter, and I put it in his suitcase and said, I think you are going to have a heart attack.
That's incredible.
So, and then I said, and if you do, I'll be so mad. So
he was terrified. Oh, so no, I've had a heart attack.
We didn't actually talk about it. We didn't talk about the letter. And then I got the phone call. So when we finally, the whole family, we get on the plane, we get over there, we struggle into the hospital room, and he's wired up and tubes everywhere. And he looks at me and says, are you mad with me? I'm like, you're half dead. How can you be asking me this question?
I'll get mad at you later when you get well.
That's right. So that's the answer to the question. God had actually given me a heads up on it. And God has done that quite a lot with me.
Isn't that incredible?
Yeah.
So here you are.
It's very unnerving sometimes.
In another phase of your life, and you know, your young kids that you had to speak to in those days and explain that challenge are grown up now. Do you ever think about heaven? Do you ever think about what it's going to be like, what it's going to look like, what we're going to experience? I mean, as you're saying, you tend to live a little bit in the present and dealing with, you know, what we have in our boat now.
Mm.
But do you dream about it? Do you think about it?
I do, like most people, you know. I mean, I have images of, like...
What do you see? What's in your heart there?
I don't understand a lot. I don't understand a new heaven and a new earth. And I have this feeling that earth, you know, there isn't going to be any pollution. I mean, what is the new earth? Is God going to restore? Are we going to be back in the Garden of Eden? I don't know, because it's so otherworld, and I love otherworldness. I love the limitations of this life, because I've never felt that this is all there is, even before I knew God.
That's an interesting phrase.
It never felt enough, really.
Yeah.
And so in my wild imaginings, I imagine, is the whole universe going to open up? And I'd like to be able to fly, if that's an option.
That's an excellent choice.
I'd like to have a go.
I'll be right with
visiting
you.
The planets. I don't know. It's great to dream.
Yeah.
But in the end, is it going to be about that? I mean, you lead choirs. I don't want to be in the one in heaven. I enjoy singing, you know, and we've been there 10,000 years. I don't want to sing for 10,000 years. That's not my idea.
No, mine neither.
Yeah. You've got to conduct us for 10,000 years.
No, thank you. No. Tired arms.
So, I don't know. I don't go there a lot.
Yeah.
I think I did when the children were little more, because we talked in images and we read C.S. Lewis and those things. But yeah, as long as, Jesus, it's not going to be now and then. It's just going to be a continuation. It's all going to be now. I mean, he's here now and he's going to be there in the now then. And so it'll all just be now, and it'll be okay.
It's amazing, though. I mean, we were just chatting about this a little bit earlier, too, the importance of hope in our lives. And you know, those of us that understand some of what the Bible speaks about heaven and Christ going to prepare a place for us, and the hope that we have in him, and an everlasting hope to be with him in paradise forever. And that sense of hope is obviously critically important for anybody going through any bit of difficulty and struggle, which of course we all face in life. And you were mentioning too, one of the fascinating things about just the exploration here is the sense of otherworldliness and the hope, however one might be searching for it. Can you just talk a little bit about what that means to you?
Yeah, I think just the hope in heaven business. I think I, very early on in the Christian life, sometimes I wonder, is this all imaginary? Hmm. You know, is our understanding, is it not going to be anything like we think it's going to be? Or is it even not going to be? I sometimes think that. And John Lennon had that song, you know, Imagine there's no heaven. And in your gut, you say, There has to be, there has to be. But that has never actually been my great place of hope. My hope is now, you know, it's in the present. It's in the, it's in this relationship with Jesus now here on earth. And so I remember as a young Christian, and I think it was Andre Crouch sang a song about even if there is no heaven, it's been worth it all.
Certainly we are in a beautiful place, and it's just a pleasure and a joy to chat with you on some of these things. So thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Yeah,
are you going to get a chance to go out and swim? Swim
today,
in the Aegean?
I will tomorrow, though.
Hopefully.
Are you going to?
I'm going to.
It's too
Absolutely.
Inviting.
I'm not going to miss that opportunity. Paul's letters were written to address situations in churches, which we are very familiar with. He dealt with sound doctrine and church leadership, but also the everyday stuff of life, like work, relationships, conflict, and money. His words spoke to people of all walks of life, populations of people who were thirsty for truth. It's the same today. Many people thirst for that truth, and not just those who would call themselves Christians. We know where that truth lies, in the Word of God, and our relationship with Christ through it. I'm Jared Earhart. Join us next time for more Living Truth.
Join us next week for an encore series from Charles and Hilary Price called Holy Land. This is Living Truth.